Hi, welcome back to Middleism Eschatology. This is Stephen Winsett, your host, and what we are doing here is the Rapture Part 2. But first, that musical interlude. You and I made worship. You and I call the love. You and I forgiven and free. You and I embrace surrender. You Okay, that was Chris Tom with Made to Worship, and give you a little bite and a taste there. You're going to have to look it up on YouTube and find it some more for yourselves and get to it. Awesome song. But that whole chorus of 50, 60,000 people in a stadium to hear a concert like that, and you just, wow, what's it going to be like when we get in heaven and the multitude are standing before him and singing, Holy, Holy is the Lord, when every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That scene. And whoever is it that said, take worship instruments worship instruments, take them out of the church. I can't fathom that. I just can't fathom that. So what we see there, just that taste of glory in heaven is just awesome. Well, we're going to the Rapture Part 2. Now, what I did in the first part was I completely laid out the whole idea of what the rapture is, what it's about, and the different elements of it. It is at the Parousia when we come all to meet him, and we meet the Lord in the air. It's very biblical scripture, including the bodily resurrection of the saints, you know, all the bodies coming out of the dust and out of the tombs, standing again. The whole word of resurrection is actually the word standing again of a Nekron. I didn't go into that last time. I probably should have this time. Might probably this time. But anastasis Nekron is the standing again of a corpse. And that's how we understand why it is a physical and bodily resurrection. I'll probably end up getting that a little bit later on. But first of all, let's go to William Bell. Oops. Let's get this out of there. And let's look at Hissing and what we're going to go through. He's got 38 minutes here, so we're going to try to go through there a little bit and listen to this, and then into part two of his thing. Should be able to get it all into one thing, but we're going to listen to him arguing about it, about the rapture, the Lord descending from heaven, and how he presents the whole argument. Understanding that William Bell is not theologically trained. In other words, he went to the Memphis School of Preaching, which doesn't teach you theology. They just teach you how to preach and the basics of the Bible, when it was written, who it was to, what it's about, you know, just basic structure outlines. But they don't teach you biblical, real theology of how it all works together. That's kind of not what the Memphis School, it is barely 2 year. I don't know if he went to any other school or anything else like that, but I know he got an honorary doctorate degree. It just foolish that somebody gave him and Don one. So here we go. Let's just listen to what he says, and I will respond and comment as we go through here.
We talked about that historical framework, and we gave you examples from the book of Acts, from chapter 11, from chapter 17 and chapter 18, where Claudius Caesar was reigning. And so at the time, the apostles wrote, Paul wrote 1 Thessalonians. It was around AD 50, 51. So during the first century. All right. And during that time, we have the events occurring in this context. So you have to realize that if you're going to talk about the scriptures, we must assign the proper historical framework for the passages that we're looking at, so that we don't take something that was written to people in the first century and begin to apply it to ourselves first as though they didn't count, as though they...
And here's the problem. I'll establish this right at the second. It is impossible for William Bell, Don Preston, or any of them ever prove that AD was the second coming. What they have to do is go back to scriptures, change definitions of wordings, change things around, this and that, to turn everything into invisible and spiritual as all happening in the spiritual realm. So there was nothing that anybody can sit there and say it literally happened. Now, when we look at the historians, they'll bring out Josephus. Now, here's the irony. How do they know it even happened in the first century? Well, they have no choice but to go to a historical, a book, something that somebody wrote about those days and said, see, there's the testimony of what happened. That's how we know that Jerusalem was destroyed according to the prophecy of Jesus there, and it happened in AD 70 because the historians wrote that. Now, if we go back to the same historians and we go to Christian historians like Eusebius, and to the people and the things that were there at that time, not one of them ever declared that was the second coming, that the rapture happened, that anybody was changed. There is not a word of it. In fact, you have Barnabas, Clement, who are two men talked about in the Bible. Of course, Barnabas was Paul's traveling companion for many years there. He said that the Jerusalem was destroyed according to the prophecies of Jesus, but he was still looking forward to a future coming. Clement, in his letter, Clement was a co-worker with Paul, appointed by Paul to be the pastor, I forget which church, I think Smyrna, but he lived and wrote a letter, and let me see, I'm going to do this for you, so you can see where I get... all this, and there's several different websites you can get this from, but this is the Church Fathers, and so we're looking at there's Clement of Alexandria, and so who is this rich man? He mentions in this book right there, now this is not Clement of Rome, but he wrote in his book there that future coming, he talked about the future coming, the Barnabas, Saint Barnabas, only one, the Epistle of Barnabas. He talked about it too, and the future second coming. And then there would be a couple of others. But see, you can go to these websites, look at this, and then you can look at what Eusebius says as church history. And he chronicled it. Now, remember, this is from 265 to 340, so he's pretty well close to it. But in book three, he talks about this time of the church and the church fathers. The first successor to Peter in Rome. After the martyr Paul and Pontus, Linus was the first to attain, so it was Linus. And then it talks about the first successor of the apostles, their names and some of them who they were. Clement, third bishop from the Church of Rome. Paul testified as a co-laborer and fellow soldier. And, Corinth, a couple others. And then he goes on to describe the last siege of the Jews after Christ. And so this is a repeat of a lot of what Josephus recorded. And he quotes Josephus quite literally all the way through. And so you can compare what Josephus wrote there, and you see it all comes true. Now, it is fitting to add to the accounts of the true predictions of our Savior, who foretold these very events. So he believes that the Olivet was completely fulfilled in those events of 70 A.D., then signs which precede the war. Then Josephus works what he left. He talks about that. The manner in which Josephus mentions the divine books. Who, Simeon of the church, Vespasian. Some of the things that would happen. Clement, the third bishop of Rome. The epistle of Clement. Hegesippus wrote. the persecution under Domitian. For instance, here, Domitian having great cruelty toward many, having unjustly put to death no small number of well-born and notable men of Rome, caused exile and confiscated their property. So it is said in this persecution that he's talking about of Domitian that the apostle Evangelist John was still alive, was condemned to dwell on the island of Patmos. So Irenaeus, in his fifth book, discusses the number and the name of the Antichrist. And then he makes that famous quote that everybody argues with. But see, I won't even go into that one. And then certain Ignatius, who was also at that time before and after. Then a narrative concerning John. The other Gospels. So you can see he gets into quite a bit of a narrative about what happened afterwards. And see, in all of that, there's nobody from anywhere that ever testified that was the second coming. Now, Roy Runyon, a few days ago, tried to pull up something from Eusebius and say, see, he talked about the coming. Well, it was very... the idea that the judgment that happened in 87 was a type, and that we're calling this a type or a shadow of a coming of judgment from Jesus or from God. So it was very appropriate to say, yeah, that was the coming of judgment. That was the coming of God on them. God came down on those people real hard when it was the Roman army who did it, but it wasn't God himself who came down out of heaven and did it. And so you'll find quotes from Eusebius and others who talk about that and talk about it as a coming of judgment, but they don't mean in the sense of the second coming. That's important to understand. All right. Shall we go?
They must be ignored for the things that were stated. So if you read the Bible and you apply the events that it's speaking to that generation first, you'll come very close to having a better understanding of what the text is saying and what it means. And then what you are to do is make a secondary application to yourself. How does that apply to me, or what principle can I learn from it? What does this mean?
Well, the fact is, he's admitting there it has to apply to me. So if AD 70 was not the second coming, then the second coming is still future. Then that means I can sit there and say, we who are alive at his coming, when it happens, will be changed. So I can apply that to me, because if Jesus comes 5 days from now, I'm not saying he was or even close to, I'm just, you know, just throwing that out here. But if he was to come from 5 days, then it would be me. I'm alive. We who are alive. That would include me.
Mean in terms of how I live and how I understand the Bible. That's what's missing in most of the Bible studies that is going on. And
see, what he's going to do, you listen to that, that's what's going on in most of these Bible studies. Well, of course, he's a preterist. There might be 500 of them in the world, right? Versus thousands and thousands of Christians. Preterism is a very minor few, very messed up view. We're all wrong. You got to remember that. We, as futurists, all of us are dead wrong because we haven't learned how to do it. So Augustine, St. Thomas Aquinas, Pope Francis, Pope John Paul II. It doesn't matter who it is that was in the church or who it is that's been here that says it's a future coming. We all are wrong. We've done it all wrong. We've never understood it from the beginning. And we conduct these Bible studies all wrong. That's what he's saying, that the church and all of us have been wrong for all these thousands of years, and we couldn't get it right until these guys came along.
Until we get into the mindset and the framework of understanding the historical setting, we're just not going to get it. Now, let me give you an example of how to apply what I just stated. All right, if you're reading 1 Thessalonians and you understand that it was written in the first century to people who were living in the first century, then when you read the nouns and particularly the pronouns, because that's where people really blow it when they read.
And nouns and pronouns. See, it was all supposed to happen to them. It wasn't supposed to happen to us. It was to happen to them, because we who are alive, Paul and all those, it had to happen in that generation. But again, they never established that it did happen.
Read the pronouns. For example, when you read this statement that says, let's take the nouns and the pronouns. All right. So if you go to the first of the book and you see where he says Paul and Silvanus and Timothy, etc., then you know those are people who are living in the first century that said. So when he makes that statement, the events that he's talking about are going to first and foremost primarily occur within the lifetime of the people who were living then.
Okay, do you understand the logic? Because Paul and them were there, and he said, we, us, you, all of those type of words, therefore it demands that the second coming and all those things had to happen. If not, those people are all liars, because they said, we who are alive, we, you, them, Paul, Timothy, we are going to have it happen in our generation, in our lifetime. So therefore, if it doesn't happen, then God is a liar, Paul is a liar, and all these other people are a liar. Because it was revealed by the Holy Spirit that it had to happen in that generation. And the problem is, of course, is that it did not happen. And so when we examine these things, how do we approach it? How do we, this audience relevance thing, you know, how does that really, how are we supposed to look at it? Well, the reality is that when Paul said, we who are alive, he included himself. I hope to be alive. That's how we can understand it. I hope to be alive. I hope I'm there. I hope I get to see that. But he wasn't. He died before then. So if this is a statement of prophecy that we who are alive, well, I'm here in the first generation, I should be alive when it happens. He's not making saying, I will be alive. Because he said we does not mean that it is prophetic. It is a hope and an expectation of what might happen, of what they hope to have happen, of what they want to have happen. But remember, Jesus said, he comes like a thief in the night. No man knows the day or the hour or anything close to it. He will come when people least expect it. And, of course, then 2 Thessalonians, the lawless man and all that will come first and be, you know, so that day can't happen until all these things happen anyway. So, the language there, this out of reverence, this thing is something taken way too far. And I'll give you a basic demonstration of that's how all prophecy kind of went. And I can prove that through Deuteronomy and this audience relevance crap of you. It was written to them, not to us. Come on. Let's go. Oh, I'm being slow. Still have internet access, but it's just going slow. Come on, baby, you could do it for me. I'm still recording. Yep. Come on. There we go. Uh-oh. We're going to have to figure out what's going on here. Hello. Okay, let's try this again. Okay, we pause there for just a second. Here we are, blessings and things. Okay, now I want you to look at these things. As we go through here, I'm just picking out verse 25. For the Lord will cause you to be defeated before your enemy. You shall go out one way against them, and you shall be a horde to the kingdoms of the earth, and your dead body shall be food for all the birds of the air and for the beasts of the earth. Wow, doesn't that sound like 80-70? There shall be no one to frighten them away. The Lord will strike you with boils of Egypt. The Lord will strike you with madness and blindness. And you shall be oppressed and robbed continually. You shall build a house, your ox, your sons, your daughter. Now here's the important part, and I'm going to read through this because this was fulfilled in 70 AD. The Lord will bring you and your king, whom you set over you, to a nation that neither you nor your fathers have known. Get that? And there you shall serve the other gods of wood and stone. You shall become a whore, a proverb. You plant vineyards. You shall have olive trees. You shall father sons and daughters, but they shall not be yours. They go into captivity. Again, goes on. then these curses shall come upon you, pursue you, and overtake you, till you are destroyed because you did not obey the voice of the Lord. You will serve your enemies, and he will put a yoke of iron on your neck until he has destroyed you. The Lord will bring a nation against you from far away, from the end of the earth, swooping down like the eagle. I'm talking about the Roman army. Wow. A nation whose language you do not understand, Latin. A hard-faced nation who you will not, shall not respect the old or the show the mercy. They shall eat the offspring of your cattle and all that. Here we go. They shall besiege you in all your towns until your high and forward water walls in which you trust come down throughout all your land. See, he keeps saying you, but he's talking about future generations. He's not talking about them specifically, because you read right into Joshua. They took over the land. They conquered it. Not everybody. They go through that. They developed in the land, stayed there until you come a time of David and Solomon, and the land divided. They were this whole time. These things did not happen until 70 AD. And you shall eat the fruit of your womb, the flesh of your sons and daughters, for whom the Lord your God has given you, in the siege and in the distress which your enemies shall distress you. The man who is the most tender and refined among you will be grudged. See, it's not talking about them specifically. Now, if you wanted to apply Bell's audience relevance, see, this was a prophecy for 2,000 years later. But yet he still used the language of, he has given you, and he kept talking about, because he was talking about their descendants, the ones that would come after them. They were the you. So this undermines his audience relevance.
All right. Michael, good morning from North Arkansas. Thomas, good morning. By the word of the Lord. Now, they're actually citing something that Jesus had already taught, that we who are alive. Now, ladies and gentlemen, did you get that? Did you really get that? Apply what we just said. We who are alive. Don't read yourself into that text. You can.
I have to read myself into the text because the second coming didn't happen. So if it happens 5 days for me, it's talking about me. We who are alive when he comes. do you see the perspective there? We who are alive. So when he comes tomorrow, if he comes the next week, so whoever is alive when he comes, we who are alive, we will be changed. The emphasis is on what's going to happen to us and those people that are alive when he comes. Not to the, never mind.
Cannot do it, not exegetically, not and be accurate in your interpretation of the scripture. And that's where all the eschatology that you hear today, where people are saying Christ is coming back soon, or Christ is coming back, period, on a cloud, that's where all of it goes wrong.
See, we're all wrong. Everybody, one of us is all wrong because he came back in 70 AD, because that verse says, we who are alive at his coming. So it therefore, that demands then that Jesus had to come back. So you check with history. Do you have any record of it happening? No. Jesus said that every eye will see him when he comes. Did everybody see him? No. Did anybody see a resurrection? No. Was anybody changed? No. Was the army of the beast defeated? No. Beast and false prophet, were they thrown into the lake of fire alive? No. Does the millennial start? No. None of those things happened. Nobody confessed that they happened afterwards. And so they want us to tell us all the church went into apostasy after 70 AD, even though Jesus said, I will build my church. The church has been wrong for 2,000 years. He never built it correctly. They've been wrong all this whole time.
It's a failure to just simply read and understand plain English. That's all it is. Bill, good morning to you.
See, he calls it plain English, but see, it's a perspective. He can't even see it the other way around, that we who are alive at his coming, the important part is when he comes, whoever, all of us, anybody, whoever it is that's alive, that's what it's trying to say. It's not we who are alive will experience it because he's got to come in our generation. See, that's a twisting of it. That's the twisting that we charge them with.
We say to you by the word of the Lord that we... Do you know Paul is including himself in that we? Now, he's not, and let me make this, add this caveat. Paul is not saying that any specific person in the group of we is going to be alive when Christ comes. He's speaking of the group itself. In other words, that in that group, some of them are going to remain alive until Christ returned, but some of them were not. And that's precisely what Jesus taught in Matthew chapter 16, 27 and 28. Matthew chapter 16.
Yeah, we know that verse. We who are standing here, some of you will not die before they see the kingdom. Well, it is talking about 80-70. That is not the second coming. We've already established in other videos that 80-70, the destruction of that was not considered the second coming, of course. And I showed you that in the other video about Parousia. It's used two different ways. The way that Matthew used it was talking about the coming of judgment. The way that Paul used it was the presence of Christ who returns bodily and physically to the earth. And 70 AD, he did not return bodily and physically to the earth. Therefore, it was not the second coming.
27 and 28. Jesus. Now, the next verse is a reiteration. It's a further explanation of what he had just said. So what did he tell you in verse 27? He was about to do this. Now, let's see how he expands on that in verse 28. Notice, he says, what?
Assuredly,
I say to you,
there are some standing here.
There are some standing here. Now, ladies and gentlemen, just ask student or scholar to see this. Just be able to read English. But they'll spell it out for you.
I have discussed things and have written books on it already about that whole differentiation of that verse, seeing the Son of Man coming on clouds. Paul never used that language, of course. And of Acts 1, of course, him coming down, there's the distinction, there's the difference. This Jesus went up into heaven, this Jesus will return at his second coming, and his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives. That is the whole difference, because it never happened. He never physically, bodily came in AD 70.
For you in English, and you will see the text. It says, I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who is about to judge. Now, I know the English says who will judge.
Okay, that's the next thing that
he's going to physically.
The word mellow. He's going to bring that out, the word mellow. So let's cut him off at the knees, and we're going to go to Acts 24:15. Okay, now, neither can you prove, now bring up gifts, but this confess you that according to the way, which they call a sect, I worship the God of our fathers, believing everything laid down by the law and written in the prophets, having hope in God, which these men themselves accept, that there will be a resurrection of both the just and the unjust. Now, that's 15. Now, he's getting ready to argue that this translation is wrong. So here we got the scholars. There will be. He will raise, there will be, there is about to be, is the Berean literal, meaning, well, I'll explain that in a minute, that there shall certainly be, there will be a resurrection of the dead, and it goes on, that there shall be. So almost every translation puts it there is, except for that Berean, and I think there might be other one. That puts in there about to, and before there will be a resurrection, that there will be a resurrection. We'll wait for there, that there is about to be a rising again of the dead. Young's Literal Translation plays with the verbiage and always tries to make it present to be a rising, and that, throw that translation out, it's not worth 2 cents. All right, so we look at the English Standard Version. Let's go to the interlinear real quick, and I'm going to explain this to you. Now, this rule comes from something understanding. We have what we call Wallace's Greek grammar, and it goes through the grammar and to help you understand. And I'll show you why that's important in just a second, because I want you to look first of all in this verse. It says right here, and there is about to be, highlight for you, but it ain't working. Melanin. There is about to be. Now, the first one is what? a present infinitive. So there is about to. And we agree that Jesus was about to cross the river. So, you know, he crossed the river very soon in time and so forth. So present means it's something that's happening right there and then. Future, infinitive middle means this is something that's going to happen later on. It's not happening right now, but it will happen on earth. Now, that word esete, to be, comes from the word I am, esete, to be. I am, I exist. It is a form of that word, and it means to be, I exist. And so it is to exist. It's about to exist. It's about to be. It's about to come into reality. It's going to happen. This resurrection is about to, and it's going to happen later on. So every one of those rules right there, you got the two for present infinitive and the future infinitive. Now, let's go to the word meaning of the word melanin. It says to be about to. That is the literal. And that's why the Berean says literal. But you look at the other one, it said about to be, right? So it didn't say that. I'm about to, I delay, I linger. So properly, at the very point of acting, about ready, about to happen, we agree. It can mean that. It is also used in general of what is sure to happen. See, those are two basic usages. Now, what does Thayer's do? One, two. It shows you the two ways it's used. One, as a participle for the future hereafter, something that is going to happen or things future to come. Perfect state of things which will exist in the thing. So let's pull up an example of this. Colossians 2:17, which are shadows of things coming. The however body is of Christ. Coming. See, it doesn't use it about to. The shadow of things coming. This is used in a general sense. It is what? Present participle active, meaning it's something that's going, it's coming to pass, of things coming, but that doesn't mean it's about to right away. It just means what? Things coming. However, body is of Christ. So that's one way it's used. And it's translated as coming. Interesting that Parousia is used that way, isn't it? Now, how else is it used? So it can be used and translated as coming, 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 coming. Now, joined with an infinitive, remember, present, infinitive, it's to be on the point of doing and or suffering with an infinitive present. That's what we just showed you. That, let's see, good example. The point of doing or suffering something. Something's about to happen. Having heard then that the centurion, having gone to the commander, he reported it, saying, what are you going to do for these men? This is a Roman. There it is. Are you going? Melly's about to. What are you going to do? Are you going? See, it doesn't say about to, does it? What are you about to do? There's the idea. What are you going to do? Or what are you about to do? See, that makes very perfect sense, doesn't it? There's present infinitive. Not future, but present, right now. That puts it in the presence of happening right there in the spot. Now, to have in mind to think to do with an infinitivist aorist. An aorist doesn't have a set time, before, past, present. It just, the idea that it's going to happen. Somewhere down the line, we know it's going to intend. So that's an infinitive present. Then with the Greek, is in Homer on down. Things which will come to pass. Or what will, it will eventually happen. Okay, it's going to happen. Let's just draw one in, out here, like 1 Peter 5:1. Let's look at it. Elders among you, I exhort the fellow elder in the witness of the Christ's sufferings, who I am also of the being about to be revealed, glory and a partaker. So the glory is about to be revealed in sufferings of the Christ, the fellow elder and witness of the sufferings of Christ, who also is a being about to about to. See, it doesn't even put to, does it? And present participle active. So right there is being about something that's kind of happened. It's being revealed in glory. How do they put that in stated in English? To the elders among you, I go to here. So I exhort the elders among you as fellow elders and witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. As well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. Doesn't say about to be. It says it's going to. So it's going to happen in the future. And that does not imply it's going to happen right now. It's just right there. I mean, he's about to get into the boat. No. It's going to. And so it's a generality. That's something that is going to happen in the future. And does not mean right away. Okay, so let's go to... We'll back her up a little bit. There we are. We're back here. Now, here's the fourth usage. In general of what is sure to happen with infinitive present. Matthew, that now it says here what? With an infinitive future. Esthe, to be. That's what I showed you in Acts 24. How are we supposed to understand Melon in that? It's in general. In general of what is sure to happen. Not what is about to or what is going to, but what is sure to happen. So if I say, let's Matthew 24, 6. We know that. And to hear the wars, the rumors were, behold, not be alarmed. It's necessary for these things to take place, but not yet. It's the end. You will begin then to hear. There it is, melanin. You will begin. Future indicative active. Do you see the other verb on there? Connected with to be? No. But you will begin. It's future. It's something that's going to happen later on down the road. And it's not about to right now, but it's going to happen in the future. That is the stress of that word. So you can't say that every time melon is used, it means about to be, but of what is sure to happen. So here it is, Acts 24, 15, the verse that we've been talking about. And here's the last one right here. To always be on the point of doing without ever doing, to delay. Acts 22, when Peter was with the Ethiopian. Hey, here's the water. What is going to prevent you from doing it now? What's stopping? What would delay you from doing it? So that word delay there, preventing, is the word melon. It doesn't mean about to. It means right now at this time period, what's going to keep you from doing it? What's going to keep you from being baptized? Why are you being delayed about it? So the word has multiple uses, but here, every single one of these verses, it is to be understood by the Greek experts in general of what is sure to happen. Not what is about to happen, but what is sure to happen. Meaning, if Jesus says in 2032, I will destroy Russia, okay? Because God said it, it's a sure thing. It's going to happen on that day. The way he says it's going to happen, it's going to happen. It is sure to happen. There's no questions about it. It might not. There's no human factor in there. God said it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And so this is the same thing at 24:15. Having this hope and guide with themselves, wait that the resurrection is sure to happen of the just and the both of the unjust. It is sure to happen. Why? Because that verb, future, makes that whole thing a thing that's going to happen. It is sure to happen in a future way, at a future time. Not coming in a general way, but it will be sure. And that's how the Greek experts have looked at that word, how they've defined it. But William Bell says they are all wrong.
Come down out of the heavens? Now, let me tell you what the problem is, ladies and gentlemen. It is a lack of understanding and appreciation for the Old Testament, for the Old Covenant Scriptures. And because we do not know the language of the prophets, we make all of these exegetical mistakes, all these interpretive mistakes, because we are oblivious, in many cases, to the language of the Old Testament.
See, you're all idiots. all you people have been Bible study, all of you that think it's all future, you are wrong. You don't know the Old Testament. I do. I'm going to explain it to you because you guys have all been wrong. You've never figured it out. Very condescending. Very condescending.
If we were as familiar with the Old Testament as we are with the New Testament, and some are not even familiar with that.
See, not even familiar. He keeps putting these negative comments about people. And who's he talking about? I don't know. I've got a Bachelor of Arts degree in theology. I've got a Master's of Divinity. I have a Master's in theology. And right now I'm halfway through working through my PhD at Ambridge. And so I'm sitting here telling you, Bell, I'm not the ignorant person out there, and I'm telling you, you're wrong. And I'm showing it to people through this video.
But especially when it comes down to eschatology, if we were familiar with the Old Testament prophets and how they express things, these passages would not cause us to stumble.
Well, here's the problem. Like in 1 Thessalonians 4, remember? What does it say? I'm going to show you something. Let's get this through the heck kid. What he is basically saying is, in order to understand the New Testament, we got to go back and understand the Old Testament. Because if we don't understand the Old Testament, we're never going to figure out the New Testament because it's all based on Old Testament language. Here's the silliness of that argument. It is so easy to show you. Paul, scholar, knows the whole Old Testament, Pharisee. What does he say? Brothers and... is it in Thessalonians? It's in, yeah. Whoops. Okay, let's go to, it's in 1 Corinthians 15. I'm going to make a point. Got to make a point. You got to hold on with me here for a second. What does it say? Blood can inherit, nor does perishable inherit. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. A mystery. Why is this a mystery? Where does it talk about the sleep and we'll be changed and everything else? Well, I showed you Isaiah 26, 19 in the last video, I believe it was. We shall not sleep. It comes from the Old Testament. We shall not all fall asleep. Daniel 12, we shall not sleep. Those in the bodies in the tomb that are in dust will rise up. So he's explaining the mysteries more fully. You don't go back to the Old Testament to try to understand what he is saying here. The Old Testament is being explained here. So when it says, and Daniel, those who sleep in the dust, some will rise to a judgment of righteous and unto another, you know, of the unjust. We not also, but we shall be changed in a moment, twinkling an eye, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will rise and perish, but we shall be changed. So he's talking about the old. He's explaining that mystery. That we will all not be dead, but we shall be changed. We who are alive will be changed. So, you know, I'm going
to
be nice.
We would know precisely what they are referring to. Good morning, Israel, Felicia.
Comfort of the scriptures might have hope.
All right. Notice the Bible says whatever things were written before time were written for our what?
Learning.
For our learning, that we, through patience and comfort of the scriptures, might have hope. Following the old covenant scriptures. Look, they rejected Jesus Christ. They were persecuting the apostles, as we've already demonstrated.
Right.
They were rebelling against the gospel message. They are not Christians. Now watch this very carefully. They were wanting to apprehend Paul so they could kill him because of the message that he was teaching. And the charge that they made against him was that he was teaching something contrary to the prophets.
And those charges were made up. They always were making it up, because what they were saying is that Jesus was the Messiah. Therefore, he wasn't the Messiah to these Jews. Therefore, he was speaking things contrary to the word. The Messiah was not supposed to be somebody who died, got buried, and rose again. Those are things that they did not understand. So, of course, they fought against it and said, Paul was that. But when Paul stood up, he says, what did he say? I'm a Jew just like you. What if, you know, I'm going off the top of my head here again. I believe it was when he became through. So that might be 20. Well, let me find it. Oh, come on. Be nice to me here. It's not 28. I can't remember right of hand. Paul in Rome. It is for this hope that I have been brought up before you, the hope of our people, the hope of the resurrection. And that's what he argued with them when he saw that they were Pharisees and Sadducees. Let's see if I spell it wrong. Okay, Sadducee. Plural. If we get the right verse. Come on, baby, you can find it for me. There it is. And Acts 23. Right there, 23. Okay? This is the one I was looking for. Okay. Okay, and when they said the dissension rose between the Pharisees and Sadducees, for the Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, nor angels, nor spirits, but the Pharisees acknowledged them all. Then a great clamor rose, and some of the scribes, the Pharisees party, stood up and contended, we find nothing wrong in this man. Why? Because he believed the same thing they did. What? The hope of the resurrection of the dead, that I'm on trial. Pharisees acknowledged them all. Pharisees' party stood up and contended, we find nothing wrong in this man. So here you have them agreeing with him. So what if a spirit or an angel spoke to him, and when the dissension became violent, the tribune of Fred Paul would be torn to pieces, commands to take him down from among them and force and bring him into the barracks because they were going to fight between themselves. But see the point there. I want you to catch that. The Pharisees did not. We find nothing wrong with this man because it was the hope of the resurrection, because they believed in it. It was the Sadducees who did not. So let's go back to William Bell's argument.
In other words, the very prophets that they had been studying Sabbath day after Sabbath day, and even daily, that very message, they were saying Paul was teaching something different from the prophets, that he has another source for his gospel.
Another source. That's not true. That's an extension, because they know he's a Pharisee, and he quoted and said, I have the same hope as the Pharisees. Do you see how he is completely twisting things around? William Bell, you should...
But watch what Paul said to them. In verse 13, he said, neither can they prove the things whereof they accuse me. Paul said, okay, you're making a charge that I'm teaching something that is not from the prophets, but he says you cannot prove it. What did he say in verse 14?
But this I confess to you, that according to the way which they call a sect.
All right. Now, this I confess to you, that the way which they call a sect. In other words, they're saying you're just some sect. You're just some cult, so to speak. He says, but this I say to you, that the way.
What? You notice how he stumbles around now, because he's got to reach for things. He's got to totally reach and twist around. But I'm showing you the other verse that he doesn't touch in Acts 23, where they Pharisees are agreed with what he is preaching. So, William Bell, you got to go back and study a little bit more, buddy.
Thessalonians, mm-hmm. I mean, excuse me, 2 Timothy 4 mm-hmm. and verse 1. It's the word mello, and it means about to. Same word Jesus used in Matthew 16:27. You see, all through the New Testament, they're telling you.
Which they themselves also accept.
Which they themselves also accept.
That there will be a resurrection.
The word will there is translated from the same word will that was in 2 Thessalonians. Mm-hmm. I mean, excuse me, 2 Timothy 4 mm-hmm. and verse 1. It's the word mello.
2 Timothy 4:1. Now, we've already gone over that. I'm not going to do it again. I just want you to look and see. He is arguing 2 Timothy 4:1. I charge you in the presence of God who is to judge. who is to judge the living and the dead by his appearing and his coming. So look at that. Who is to judge? Let's see. We're looking at the interlinear. Being about to judge. See, that's the one about to judge. Present infinitive active. This one is the present participle. Participle. That means it's being taken a different way. Being about to judge. Jesus Christ, the one who will. So this is 2 Timothy 4:1. Let's look inside the thing here and see if it's one of those that are listed. 2 Timothy 4:1. I'm looking. 1 Timothy 4:8. Nope. It might not be one of those that are listed. There it is. 2 Timothy 4:1. As in the Greek word of those things which will come to pass, or which one will do or suffer. Doesn't mean about to. It says it will come to pass. There you go, folks. He's wrong. As wrong as rain. It's not about to, but it's, what does it mean? Will come to pass, and that's why it's translated that way. I'm sorry, but he's not a Greek grammar expert.
Oh, and it means about to. Same word Jesus used in Matthew 16:27. You see, all through the New Testament, they're telling you this was about to happen.
See that? All the way through the New Testament, he keeps translating that word in one way and one way only. The Greeks show you five different ways, two basic ones, five different ways that it's used, one even for delay. So again, he has not done due diligence.
All right,
study.
Start over. Resurrection of the dead was about to occur. All right, let's go to Acts 26, verses 22 and 23. This is important information, ladies and gentlemen. I know you want to hear me talk about descending out of heaven. I assure you we're going to get there. Looked at them. It's there in the text. So these were things that were about to come. So what did Paul say? I have done this from day one, and I'm continuing to do it, and I'm saying no other things. Do you get that? No other things than those which Moses and the prophets said were about to come. Now, what was it that was about to come?
That the Christ would suffer.
That the Christ would suffer. Now, I'm going to come back and explain that in a moment, because it's something that our Bible students need to know about that text when we refer to it, because they make an objection right there. So I'm going to address the objection so you understand what it is. We're not going to dodge it. We're going to address the objection that they make when we tell them that this says it's about to come. And so he says that the Christ would suffer. Go ahead.
That he would be the first to rise from the dead.
That he would be the first to rise from the dead.
And would proclaim light to the Jewish people.
Okay, I'm going to go on from there.
So how could you say the term about to means something that was soon to occur in the future?
Because that's what the
word 1 Thessalonians into our future isn't going to work. And look back to your Old Testament and in the New Testament scriptures and see how the New Testament fulfills the Old Testament, not at the cross, but very soon thereafter in the lifetime of first century saints. Then you come closer to the truth. Then you have an understanding of what the Bible is teaching. And you can call any of those futurist preachers, tell them to call me up, and see if they can refute what I just said. When they were saying that Christ was going to suffer, that's when they were saying that the end time was going to occur. In those same last days, but it was soon to come. So the way you measure the term about to, the term mello for a recent past in the scriptures, something that had recently occurred, the environment or the context in which it is found.
The chariot, the wheel of a wheel, which made me kind of think that about a UFO, way before our time or somewhat. And It was also mentioned that Christ was descended to heaven. And, well, anyway, I'm kind of confused, but...
Yeah, he is.
It's the Lord descends. And so we'll talk about that a little bit. So make a note on your paper over there, okay. Saki. And...
Well, it looks like I might have to go to four because I do want to... we got to go to the next one. We got to go to the next one. I've got to go do it. You've got to be able to look at it, what more he says. I think I've covered enough here and dealt with it and showed you about Mello, what Mello actually means, how it's used different ways. He denied it, and some of the things he goes about Paul teaching the resurrection, where the Pharisees agreed with what he said. And so he pulls out something else and twists it around. So I will leave it at that. You can look at the evidence yourself, and I will come back with a part three. Okay, thanks, guys, for listening and sticking around. I hope this was a little bit better for you. You have a good night.